So let's get into the Maimer. Alpi Anal Yesh Lomar. According to what we said, we're going to now start from, I think it's seven lines down, from page Kuf Lamed Gimel. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Alpi Anal Yesh Lomar. According to what we said, She'ikur Inyan Darai Mehemna, that the main concept of the faithful shepherd, who Zeshu Zan Mefardis Amuna Atzma, is that he feeds us the faith, that the faith should be not only as it is in from the perspective of the mazel, right? In other words, that you're not believing God only because your soul above sees God, your mazel, but you're actually believing in God because you've tapped into the true essence. And therefore, this that Moshe draws down our faith into a panemius, which means we understand godliness now. It's not just some aloof concept, but you like wrap your head around your own faith. Who totsamizeh? That's actually an outcome from this. Shuzan mefarnes samuna atzma. Right? It's an automatic outcome that when he's going to bring our faith into a panemius, we're going to automatically like understand our faith, right? Because understanding is another way of bringing a makif into a panemius. Right, one can believe in a way that they just sort of don't know why, but they're just believers, right? But you get to a point where you learn enough, you have like the reasons behind it, and it makes perfect sense to you, and you don't just believe, you know, right? Hamshachas v'gilia. So when Moshe brings us into the state of connecting to us to our faith itself, the essence. Then an outcome of this is that we suddenly have das and understanding. We know Hashem. Hamshach v'gilu emuna kamoshi mitzad etzem anasham. And he says, Hamshachas emuna b'penimiyas b'das hu ayidei gilu yiskashrus atzmis de'etzem anashama. Why do you get this das? Because as we've been saying, you're connected to the essence. V'al pi zeh yesh lomar. According to all we said so far, we can say, t'bezeh shebedora shehu t'richol mesiris nefesh b'poel, that those generations that actually needed to have real mesiris nefesh, Chizku Roa Yisrael. So the shepherds of those generations strengthened the people, right? Those were the extension of Moshe in each generation. They strengthened the Amunah of the Jewish people to bring them to a state of Mesiris Nefesh. They revealed the concept of the Raya Mehemna more than Moshe Rabbeinu did himself, right? And that's kind of the Chiddush of the whole conversation here. That even though Moshe is the Raya Mehemna, as we said, Moshe did not really need to bring, only in theory Moshe brought the people to real Mesiris Nefesh. When they said, we will do and then we will understand. Like, in other words, meaning to say they were ready for Mesiris Nefesh. But because times did not descend to such exiled type times, they didn't actually have to die for God. Only in their lowest state. So in their lowest state, it became revealed from the shepherd what he really could do, which is to bring them to a state of being willing to die for God. Therefore, he brought out the concept of what the Raya Mehemna is, the shepherd of faith, more than Moshe himself. Because the drawing forth and the revelation of faith that comes from the essence, which comes through Moshe and his extension every generation, its main expression shows up as Mesiris Nefesh. In other words, it can show up as Das, an understanding, or it can show up as Mesiris Nefesh. And let me just try and make this a little bit more simple in layman's terms, right? A person can, you know, be a, like every Jew is a believer, right? But you find Jews that are going around not doing any mitzvahs. We're just saying that you have a belief which you're not attached to. You haven't internalized it. So you come and you teach him Torah. And he comes to a Hasidic class and he's like, oh, I have a soul and Nefesh Bahamas, Nefesh Elokis, and this is what my impulses are coming from. And okay, now I get it. And I understand that when you do a mitzvah, it brings down divine light. And when you do an Avera, it feeds the klippas. It starts to, all the things start to tick. So therefore he can go ahead and accomplish Torah mitzvahs, not just from a standpoint of pure faith. Like, I have no idea what I'm doing. I don't know who this God is, but do you want to wrap me up in tefillin, mister? Go ahead. No, he starts to understand. And therefore, he's practicing his Judaism because he's internalized his faith and he understands it. So that's something that he got from Moshe. Because when you read Torah, all those things I said, Nefesh Bahamas, Nefesh Elokis, the soul, the klippas, this, all that is Torah, right? All those things that Moshe taught us. So when Moshe teaches you these things, he feeds you your faith. It becomes internalized. But is this guy who now just learned why spiritually significantly he should put on tefillin, is he ready to die if someone comes and puts a gun to his head? That's a whole nother level of internalization, Right? That's basically realizing that you and the mitzvahs are one. And that it's your nature to such a degree that it's not something that you're really choosing to do in a certain sense. Your soul is like, is built to do that and nothing else. And it can't deny God even if it wanted to. So to make a person have that level of realization, it only really shows up when death is on the line. When someone's basically willing to say, I'm going to take away your existence for this belief. You say, nothing I can do about it. It's all yours. Right? So Moshe, when he pulls that out of the Jew, then we can say, you've truly fed us our faith of the highest caliber. And so therefore, the Moshe of the darker generations was able to be more Moshe than Moshe himself. Mm-hmm. That's the point. Well, Zion.
They were in unity as well. Right? You said that during Mordecai's time, with the decree, that was the time that since Matan Torah, they didn't have a mountain over their heads. They actually acquiesced to their mission, and they were unified as one. Everybody. There was that idea that Akashverus had dominion over all of them at once.
They were unified. Yes.
When they say there's no one greater than Moshe, than Moshe, that he was the highest.
Right.
Does that imply that is also his Gibulim, or does that just?
Yeah, the whole Moshe from beginning. The Rebbe addressed that one time. And he said, "How can this, it says there's not going to arise another Lo Kam Od Kamoshe. There's not going to be another one like Moshe." But Moshe lives for a very long time, and in all the generations, there's no one like him. Zion, Behina Yedua. Okay, this, by the way, this paragraph is inserted. It's really just like a standalone, like wondrous thing the Rebbe's about to say. Its association with the rest of the Maimer in terms of just understanding the concept the Rebbe is delivering, it doesn't necessarily add much. It's basically just the Rebbe's telling you once and for all what's going on with his father-in-law, essentially, and really the identity of this person in our times, right? So the Rebbe was extremely vocal about identifying the Moshe of the generation. And this, in his final mimer, he takes a whole chapter just to do that and like to prove it to us in certain, like, you know, Torah type proof ways. So we'll see. So he says, Hine Yedua Shamasiris Nefesh B'Poel Al Torah Mitzvah Shel Kol Yisrael. The actual, and this actually, Yaakov, is what you were just getting to. The readiness to die in actuality for Torah mitzvahs for every single Jew. Right? When did this quality fully come out? Once and for all in history that we saw, like, what Moshe can do to us, every single one of us, this was for in Purim, right? We never saw every single Jew at one time being ready to die for Hashem, pull that level of intense faith out of us until Purim, at the time of the decree of Haman. So Mesiris Nefesh to Hanukkah, say, wait, we had a big miracle of Hanukkah, Matisyahu and his sons are ready to die for God. He says, at the time of the Greeks, yeah, Matisyahu and his sons were ready to die for God, but that was pretty much it. There was like eight guys that like presented this level of intense Mesiris Nefesh. Everybody else was sort of dragged along. The Mesiris Nefesh b'zman gezeras Haman ha'isa b'chol Yisrael, whereas in Purim, every single Jew was living a Matisyahu life, right? He was just out on the street saying, like, kill me if you want, but you're not going to take away my Jewish star. Now, based on this, we want to explain what it says in the Maimer on the Midrash, where it says Mordechai hayashakul bedura kamosha shebedura. We mentioned this Midrash before, from the Midrash of Megillas Esther, and it says that Mordechai was equal in his generation as Moshe in his generation. We pointed this out, and that's actually a statement of the Chazal. And it says, the Hagam, she's Pashtus de Moshe hu b'chol dor. So why does the Chazal, okay, it happens to be over there that it's the Midrash of Megillah. So it makes sense they're talking about Mordechai. But the truth is, why, nonetheless, like, why don't we find each generation telling me that, you know, Yoshua in his generation was like the Moshe's generation, and Eli in his generation, and David in his generation was the Moshe. The statement that we sort of learn that Moshe, in fact, lives in every generation, we learn from Mordechai. It's a clear and open statement, right? So it's why, if there's an extension of Moshe in every generation, nonetheless, Isa b'midrash Mordechai dafka hayashaka b'dura kamoshe b'dura. It says specifically, we learn this from Mordechai. V'yesh lomer, we want to say, Shamaylos, the Mordechai Yehudi, who shehu, hayarai mehem, the Megiloi, shall call Yisrael Shabaduro. And so what did Mordechai have going, let's say more than the others, is that Mordechai, the Jew, was the faithful shepherd, in the Rebbe puts in italics, in an open and obvious way to every single Jew. In other words, like his dominance over the generation was just obvious to every single person that existed at that time. Bedugmas Moshe Rai Mehemna Shahim Sheikh Dasta Kol Yisrael Shabaduro. Just like Moshe Rabbeinu. You know, in a generation of Moshe Rabbeinu, no one's going to like scratch their heads and like, who's really in charge around here? You know what I'm saying? He was the ultimate, but the difference was that Moshe was called the Dor Deah. Moshe was called the generation of knowledge because, as we mentioned a moment ago, primarily the way that Moshe did his Raya Mehemna thing, he shepherded the faith, was to make them perceive and understand godliness. As said before, there was no need to bring them to a state of actual mysterious nefesh because God was fighting all their battles. They didn't have to sacrifice their life. So the first time Moshe showed up again in such a profound and obvious way, where he was the leader of everybody in an obvious and clear way, was Mordechai, who was the Raya Mehemna, not only in das, in a knowledge, but in readiness to sacrifice your life, which, as we said, is the ultimate purpose of the Raya Mehemna. Kamuvan gam mizeh shedura shel Moshe, kol anshei dura nikra dura deah. Yeah, and I sort of jumped ahead. That's why the generation of Moshe was called the generation of das, because that was the extent of his feeding them their faith. But how did Moshe demonstrate his being the Raya Mehemna for all the Jewish people? He did it in Das, and Mordechai, as we already said, he did it in Mesiris Nefesh, and the brackets. So here, this little line is essentially, you know, it's like the Rebbe throws this in a lot of different places, but here it is in Atta Tetzaveh, the final mimer. It's intended to be meditated on and internalized. In other words, right in the middle of Rebbe explaining how the Raya Mehemna, you have to internalize faith. This is what we must internalize regarding the faith of the Raya Mehemna in our generation. And he says as follows, Yesh lomer da'al yedei shemevi ba'mimer masha kasu shemordechai beduro hayashako kamosha beduro. The very fact that the previous Rebbe brings this medrash in his mimer, and highlights this notion that Mordechai in his generation was the Moshe of his generation, was equal to Moshe in generation. It's like a wondrous thing that he says here. He says, by simply saying it in his mimer, my father-in-law made a psak din on himself. Shahu harai mehem de magilu shakol anshe hador. That he is the open and clear leader of every single Jew in his generation. In other words, what he's trying to say is that the Rebbe's not the first one to be sort of radically pointing out who's in charge. He's trying to say that my father-in-law already, by bringing to everybody's attention this concept of the Raya Mehemna, and then settling it in, saying like, you see, Mordechai was like Moshe. In other words, don't think that Moshe was like a guy who lived a long time ago. He keeps coming up, and if he rises up to the point that he mamish is obviously bringing the entire generation to a state of mysterious nefesh, then you could point to him and say he's the Moshe of the generation. So what he's saying is, since the Friedrich Rebbe said that in his mimer, he makes a psak din, that's a serious word. He legally rules al pi Torah that is referring to himself, the previous Rebbe. And of course, by extension, we can say the same thing. The fact that our Rebbe is saying not only that Mordechai was the Rebbe in his generation, and that his father-in-law was the Rebbe, he's also making a psak din on himself. Something which is obvious that, you know, people can deny, even, by the way, we're in Parshas Korach, so if you're going to say, well, maybe it's this guy, even in Moshe's generation, some people are saying, maybe it's this guy, but it's ridiculous, and there's a whole Parsha set aside to show the ridiculousness of such a position. The Rebbe, right, everyone knows, Rosh B'nai Yisrael, they don't even know his name, he's just Rebbe, right, stands for Rosh B'nai Yisrael. So the Rebbe's basically signing off. This, you know, I have to stop here and just, like, take a moment to bring us to reality and wake you up. This is the Rebbe saying, like, here you go, guys. I'm not going to see you for a while, but I want to remind you where the connection lies. That the Atta Tetzaveh, who's going to bind you to the Orein Sof and bring out your essential faith, and then hopefully you'll bring me some olive oil when the time comes, is me, right? So this is the idea. Now, you're going to say, as we should ask, himself. That's a good question.
I'm saying, like, David the Melech died, and when the generation died, ends,
and obviously their spiritual,
right. Like the Rebbe is saying this over 40 years after his Rebbe died. And yet he's saying that he's passing on himself, right?
No, that's fine.
And what does the Rebbe call his father-in-law when he says this? He calls him Muri v'cham, like Admor, right? Muri v'chami Admor. What does Admor mean? Adonai Nemorein Rabbeinu. In other words, as far as the Rebbe was concerned, the Rebbe wasn't even the Rebbe. His father-in-law was the Rebbe.
But he was the Rebbe.
Period. The Rebbe, for the entire duration of his leadership, never referred to himself as the leader of the Jewish people. He would constantly say, the Rebbe de Shver. Right? Like he was a shliach of his father-in-law who was continuously being the Rebbe, as the whole time the Rebbe was leading and the Rebbe would say that even when his father-in-law sort of fell ill and he would sit in a separate room, right? And he put the Rebbe in charge of the Hasidim in order to give the Fabrengen because the Friedrich Rebbe was too weak to do it. So he like appointed the Rebbe to sort of just like stand in. That's how the Rebbe saw his entire 40 years of leadership. That he was just like, his father-in-law was in the other room being the Rebbe, and the Rebbe was sort of just telling everybody what his father-in-law wanted to hear. So now, why do I bring that out? Because if you're going to say, well, you know, once the Rebbe died, who's going to say that? The Rebbe is a pretty serious Torah scholar. I think we can agree that if he finds it to be with simple pshitas, that 40 years after his father-in-law dies, he's still calling him the Rebbe, the leader of the generation. Here, we're only 27 years after the Rebbe passed away. So in other words, to come along and have this concept that is somehow like not fair game anymore, that the Rebbe, because he passed away, is not the Rebbe? Ask the Rebbe that. He held for 40 years after his Rebbe passed away, that he was still mamish leading the generation and 100%, like nothing happened.
No, I'm asking who is a practical leader, because you're saying after he passed away, he's still the leader, that's fine, but there's always a physical leader.
So there's not a physical leader. So the way I learn it is like this. First of all, there always is a physical leader. I agree with you even more than you know. But you want to shake hands anytime with you? What you need to know is like this, right? And this is, we read a Hachnasa Sefer Torah last night just by Hashgacha Pratis, right? This, I'm going out of the bounds of this mimer for a second because the Rebbe's asking us to. This is like a, why is he saying this? You know, he's telling you, let's forbring for a second at this point in the mimer, right? So, l'chaim. So he's saying as follows. 1970, right? Tavshin Lamed was a very, very, very special year on Yud Shvat of that year. What is Yud Shvat significance? That's the day of the Yortzeit of the previous Rebbe. And it's simultaneously the day that the Rebbe, so to speak, took the leadership. And in Russia, the previous Rebbe began writing a little Sefer Torah. It was a little one, right? A little Sefer Torah. And he said and he declared, this is going to be the Torah of Mashiach. And he wasn't joking around. Everyone understood this. They're like, you're writing Mashiach Sefer Torah? He's like, yeah, and we're all going to write it together. Everyone chip in your 100 shekels, and we're going to... And then the war happened, World War II. And whatever happened with this Sefer Torah, Mashiach's Torah was like in the like almost done. It was in the middle. It was like got stuck in a room somewhere. It was like everyone's dying. Who knows what's going on with this Torah? It's like old news. All of a sudden the war ends. Somehow this Torah like comes out of hiding. And the Rebbe, 20 years after he took on the leadership of being the Rebbe, he pulls out this like Mashiach Sefer Torah. And he's like, we're making a Hachnasa Sefer Torah of Mashiach Sefer Torah. We're writing and finishing Mashiach Sefer Torah.
Again?
Not again. They didn't finish it the first time. They were in the middle of it, right? The Rebbe took it out of hiding and he's like, we're finishing the Sefer Torah. So if you read accounts of the Hasidim of that Fabrengen, 1970, they're mind-boggling. You're talking about like grown adult men, rabbis, like they were all in such an anticipation of Mashiach, like revealing himself at that. Because remember, the Rebbe had already been the Rebbe for 20 years. And man, the Rebbe for 20 years changed the entire face of Judaism like forever. Right? Past, present, and future. So this was not a regular person. And here he's coming out on his like inauguration day, because Yud Shvat was anyway the day that the Rebbe became the Rebbe. And he announced to get everyone ready before, we're going to finish writing Mashiach Sefer Torah. People, Pashit, thought Mashiach was going to come right then and there. And there's like many, many, many eyewitness accounts in people's diaries that they were like trembling in fear because they thought literally the Rebbe was going to stand and put the crown on his head. Right? So in the middle of that Fabrengen, the Rebbe gave an amazing sicha, which answers your question. And he said, we're 20 years from the passing of my father-in-law, And he said, it's time to point out a concept. There's a Tosafos that in, I think in Gemara of Shabbos, I don't remember exactly where it is, we can look it up, where he explains that there's actually two versions of the Tanakh. Really, we only have one version of the Tanakh, but in some time in the previous history, there was in existence some other version, right? And it said over there, one version said regarding Shimshon HaGibor, that he led the Jewish people for 20 years, and another version said that the fear of him was on the police team for 40 years. So we don't have that version anymore, right? He led the people for 20 years, but it's brought that there is such a concept that and it was, apparently it was mamash, having two versions of the Tanakh is not a simple thing, right? That's like a serious claim in its own right, right? So what is the claim that the fear of the police team of Shimshon was on the police team for an extra 20 years, right? So the Rebbe explains how these two things go together. He says even though he really passed away, the fear of him.
Wait, you just said he passed away.
He passed away, right? The fear of him was on his enemies for 20 years after he passed away. And that's what it means that like there's two versions, because really he only led them for 20 years, but it says in a version that he led them for 40 years, and it says that they were like our enemies were at bay for 20 extra years, even though the leader was not physically there. Now the Rebbe points out this is a very rare occurrence. There's always a physical leader. If you go through the whole Tanakh and you go through the whole, you know, you look at the Rambam, he literally lists in the Hakdama of the Rambam every single generation who its leader was, from Moshe until Rav Ashi, and then from there on also, from till today. There's never a time when we're like leaderless. The Jewish people have a Raya Mahem, and we have a faithful shepherd. But there was a time, based on this like unique period, where the Shimshon actually died, and there wasn't a leader for 20 years, and yet the fact that points out, that everybody points out, that his fear was on the enemies, means that even though you couldn't see him, his physical presence was to such an extent that actually our enemies were kept at bay, which means that he did have a physical presence in this world. Ah, he might have been buried and no one saw him for 20 years, but he was the physical leader nonetheless, to the point that a spiritual leader cannot keep you safe from your enemies, right? So
that's psychology, right? No.
But the Rebbe's point was, you can call it what you want, the Rebbe's point that he was trying to bring out, because remember, it was 20 years from his father-in-law's passing. And he was trying to explain that you think my father-in-law has not been here for 20 years, and you were writing Mamash Mashiach Sefer Torah, his Sefer Torah, because he is here. And the fact that you don't see him physically doesn't mean that you have a clear view of reality. He's because you're right, there has to be a physical presence of the leader, and we have an example in Torah that even when there isn't, apparently the only time, even though there isn't a physical presence of the leader, he is physically present with us nonetheless. So this is the way that, again, you and I can sit here and argue till the cows come home. But as far as the Rebbe's concerned, the absence of the physical leader is impossible. And therefore, even when you see him absent, he is actually physically present. And that's why the Hasidim, look, there's a lot of very sophisticated Chabad.
No one fears Chabad anymore.
Well, really no one fears Chabad. I don't know what you mean. No. But anyone should ever have feared Chabad, my friend.
I thought there was supposed to be fear.
Like I'm saying, listen, the point is, I don't know what you're going over there. Again, as far as the Rebbe is concerned, right? You can have Korachs in your generation. But the Rebbe's trying to point out that it's a foregone conclusion that the leader of world Jewry is the Rebbe, right? And it was my father-in-law, and by extension, it's him, right? So if you're even going to put another person's name on the table, it's embarrassing for that person, right? Because it's, don't even talk about it. Like, no one can hold a candle to this person, right? It's just like his godlus in Torah and Nigla and Nister and miracles and Avos Yisrael and his extension of his influence 27 years after he passed away. I mean, he's still mamish like opening up like 50 new Chabad houses every year. This is an unparalleled reality that we've never seen since the beginning of time. Forget about, right?
David HaMelech is much bigger.
David HaMelech.
How could you say that?
Because if you think
so
about
why
it.
Should I not say that David HaMelech is still alive and he's right. The one who's my leader? I would take David HaMelech any single day before I take the Rebbe. He was greater than the Rebbe 1,000 billion times. He knew 6,000 Mishnayos of Shas by heart inside
can,
out.
Can I give you
every
a small insight
knew,
into reality for a second?
Just by seeing his face.
Let me give you a small insight into reality.
All right. right.
Tough guy, right?
Not tough
According
guy.
To what we're saying in Hasidus, Moshe Rabbeinu lives forever.
Right.
Which means, and as Chaim was saying, his consciousness does not stop from one body to the next. So when David HaMelech was Shlomo HaMelech, then you would be an apikoros and a fool to say that David HaMelech is your Rebbe, the greatest man that ever lived, because now David HaMelech is not only David HaMelech, he's also Shlomo HaMelech. Which means that he gets greater as he goes. So to pick up a guy from the past and say
you're
that, no, I'm picking the Rebbe, I'm picking the Rebbe, my little man. I'm picking the Rebbe over, picking the Rebbe over the other people of his generation. Well, my point is, I'll shake your hand again. My point is that because I'm not picking the Rebbe, I'm also picking David HaMelech, who then became Shlomo HaMelech, and all the great kings, and the Rambam, and the Rashi, all of that, Godlus. So as much as you got excited and angry and ferocious when you talk about David HaMelech, imagine compounding that by 1,000 times. That's the Rebbe. That's the fear of the Rebbe. And you want to tell me people don't have fear of Lubavitch? I can't even mention his name. Now, those Korachs in the world who don't understand this reality, if you would explain to them that there is such a thing as the Raya Mehemna, point to them to the Zohar, that he's Pashtusa de Moshe Shebechol Dora, right? They don't know such a thing exists, so their faith is not yet Pepinimius. They believe in such a thing called Mashiach. But that if they just teach them the mimer. If they understood that what they're looking, when they go into the Rebbe's room in Yechidus, and they're looking at Moshe and Yoshua and David and Shlomo all wrapped up in one thing, they're going to jump out the window for fear. Right? We just heard a story from the Rebbe Rashab came to one of his, he like surprise visited one of his Hasidim who was sitting in a moving train in one of his seats, and he was like smoking a pipe in his pajamas. The Rebbe Rashab like walked into the room and he was so frightened he jumped out of a moving train, right? So you have to internalize such a faith, right? In other words, so My point is,
is godless. I'm talking about if there's going to be a person.
And what I'm trying to say is whether there is, I answered you the question right away.
Yeah. I don't think so, you did.
Well, because my point is that no, I'm not. I'm going straight for it. Right. What I'm trying to say is what the Rebbe explained in that famous Fabrengen was that the absence of your ability to see this person does not make him go away. And he's still here. Now, if you want to find out if he's going to come back in his present body or in some other body, it's of no interest. What do we care about what he looks like? He is a beautiful man. But the point is that he's the Rebbe now, just like he was the Rebbe before when he was embodied, when you don't see his body, and maybe we'll see his body again. But it's immaterial in terms of your connection with the Raya Mehemna. He didn't go anywhere. Just like Shimshon, he was still mamish physically leading the Am Yisrael in the times when we couldn't see him. And that's the answer to your question. I'm not going around it in any way, right? He's still the Rebbe. So if you're still searching who's going to be my Rebbe now, you have not internalized the faith. You don't know what's going on. He's the Rebbe now, right? And this is what confuses people. So sometimes people want to look for someone in the past. And I'm not angry with what you're saying, like your righteous intensity of David HaMelech is my Rebbe. It's not, he's also my Rebbe. It's a misunderstanding of the concept. Or where's the Rebbe now? A misunderstanding of the concept. I'm excited because these are questions which are coming from a place of misunderstanding a vigorous misunderstanding to the point of attack. It has to be clarified in a very deep way. Maybe you're not, but I'm not speaking to you. I'm speaking to all the people in the world who have the same difficulties. Listen. You got excited when you said, Chas v'shalom to tell me that your Rebbe is greater than David HaMelech. So I'm telling you, right? I'm telling you, many people have such a statement.
That's basically Kabbalah.
In fact, I'll tell you something. I saw letters from you know, there's like the Yichi movement, right? Inside of Lubavitch. So the leadership of Lubavitch today is extremely opposed to this. Right, in intense terms, right? And the fact that sort of like people around here run around with it, we don't say much because we're working with Baal Tshuvas, we don't want to get people all confused over nothing. But really, the established Lubavitch is extremely opposed to this view. And I saw letters written back and forth from Eretz Yisrael to the heads of the movement when right after Gimel Tamaz, when the Rebbe passed away. And they were trying to say, like, because in the end of the Rebbe's life, towards the end of the Rebbe's physical life that we could see, we have to now clarify that, right? He was very vocal about, like, sort of the identity of the leader. Who's the Raya Mehemna? Here he's saying, my father-in-law. Other places in these final years, he was extremely, like cluing us in. It was almost like those like Beatles tapes. You like hear it backwards. You're like, Paul is dead on it from before your time. But there was like clues. He was just dropping clues like all over the sichas, like, and people were just getting it like every week. And he was basically like pointing a finger, but you know, in his humility, he never said, but like he's just lining your sights up. And so people started saying, like, I think the Rebbe wants us to start telling everybody who he is. And then when he passed, and so that was like it was on the rise, and people were talking about it, and they made a declaration. Rabbanim, hundreds of rabbanim signed the Rebbe's Cheskes Mashiach. They printed, they put all over the world. They were having parties in every city and town, like welcoming Mashiach. It was heightened. The Rebbe, it was during the Gulf War, and there was like a scare of like annihilation of Eretz Yisrael. The Rebbe stood up, he said, not one person's gonna get hurt. And 39 Scud missiles fell in the middle of Tel Aviv, buildings were leveled, and like, there's a picture of one guy with like his head under like cement, like, I'm okay. Like, it was bamash a miracle, right? Like, the Rebbe was openly like just demonstrating Baal Shem Tov Mises like on the news everywhere. And so people were going there. Then when the Rebbe passed away, there was a big question, like, do we continue with this? Because Shimshon is still alive and his fear of is on the police team or not? So this really was like the beginning of like, do we go ahead and like announce Yechi Adonenu or like shut up about that? And one of the reasons that I saw, and this was like very, not everyone has access to these like special writings because I got myself all involved in this conversation. So like, I was you, right? I was arguing with it. And so they pulled out like all kinds of like secret documents to show me, what was going on, right? I can't really mention names here, but right? And so what they said, there was an argument back and forth. They said, look, if we are going to go with this, people are going to say, why should the Rebbe be Mashiach? Let it be David HaMelech. Let it be Shlomo. So trust me, I'm not yelling at you. What you're bringing forth is the fear of all, and the misunderstanding of all of Am Yisrael at that time. It's a good question. Okay? And the answer that I'm giving you is the answer which is so complex and so sophisticated that you have to actually sit down and teach a person what is the Raya Mehemna, how does the soul travel through every generation and compound on itself. So you can't really put that on a slogan. Because if you put that on a slogan, this guy's Mashiach, they're going to say, well, I'll take David any day. Because they don't understand the conversation. So you have to be very careful with how you present these things. Because if you don't present it in like a whole mimer and 10 mimerim and a whole yeshiva, after 2 years, maybe you'll walk out like, Mamash, oh, I get this. Yeah, I'm totally comfortable with this. You can't just put that on a slogan so easily. You can. And those who follow, follow. Those who right. don't follow will hate you. And this is what you're talking about today. Like, where's the fear of Lubavitch? People's like belittle because they don't understand what's going on. And as soon as they do understand what's going on, just like Misnagdim of all ages, right? From the time of the Baal Shem Tov until now, our greatest Hasidim started out as our greatest opponents. They came and say, who do you think you are? Like, changing Judaism, Mr. Baal Shem Tov. And they would attack him and they would argue him. And then all of a sudden they would come into his presence, they would realize his godlos and they would sign up. And then they would create a whole like dynasty of their own. This is how it works. Like you, because Jews have a right to, more than question. Like if you're going to change something, you're going to announce something in a 4,000 year old religion, which prides itself on being unchanging, and you're going to come and change something, the onus of proof is on you, not on all your followers. Like we've had plenty of false messiahs along the years, right? So if you're going to come and start saying these things, you got to better back it up or we're going to just trash you in a second. Like we're good at that. We do not allow foreigners to enter into our perfect world. But the Rebbe's good at it. And he's chidushim after chidushim after chidushim. Anyone who comes near his fire, he takes them. You can't get out of it because he's greater and better than any other person in the generation. And they keep putting that forward even 27 years later. I'm going to lose it now. I'm out of here.
Wait. Before you ask. But it was just, like you said, as if I was attacking. I just said that it's
fear. Honestly, I'm talking mamish to the right. Objective world. You're just you. Yes, I love right. you, man. What do you mean?
No, because I meant like Shimshon, after he died, there was that fear. And the Rebbe, after he died, there was still that fear from Chabad. When I said that they don't fear Chabad, I meant this idea of Raya Mehemna is one thing. The second thing, if the Torah is still out there catching the fire is still pulling people. And I feel like that fire, like, you know, you have the Lita. I was in Jerusalem. it fires all over. No one knows. Everyone are clueless. No one knows where light, right and left are.
But put it like this. Tzfat. Put it like this. Let's look at Tzfat. Let's look at Tzfat. Right. Let's just look at Tzfat. So you can understand, like the Rebbe himself would often say, make sure the message gets out. And if using my name is going to tamper with it, then dafka don't use my name. Right. He was a humble person. He was speaking the truth. So just take a look at Tzfat, right? What we're looking at over here is a city which is now mamash like a blazing city of Torah. I mean, in its own little way, right? We have two different Hachnasa Sefer Torah at the same time last night in Tzfat from two different shuls and different communities. It was like a milestone probably since the Arizal, right? We're on the rise. Yeah. And the idea is that when I came here 20 years ago, there was like literally chickens running around the streets, okay? There's still some chickens in the streets, but you know what I'm saying? It was like, When the Rebbe told his shluchim to come to this city, he gave them a mandate to turn what was basically like a hippie artist colony, failing town, where all there was no more like real religiosity in this place. There was a few like altar, you know, like Sephardish guys that were sort of all their children were going moving to Tel Aviv. Like it was emptied, and he said, Tzfat Zera Kodesh, all the shuls that you see now so beautifully decorated, they were all broken down. There was nothing left, right? In 1952, the Rebbe had his brother buried in Tzfat. And in my opinion, that was like we're about to change the situation. And he sent here 10 shluchim, right? And then he sent another 10 shluchim, right? And then another, and he sent an army of people here to radically transform this place. They opened up to my count now 45 different institutions. And the streets are humming with Torah, and the whole place has turned into a Torah town. Now every guy who walks in here, does he say, oh, like, thanks Chabad for making Tzfat like you know, return to its former glory? No, because Rebbe doesn't say, you have to use my name. We like to use his name. He's not interested in using his name. But when you say, you know, where is it? I don't recognize him, right? I don't see it. It's like you're looking at a giant and you're looking like at his toenail. You're saying, I don't see any giant over here. Where's the giant, right? You don't understand the influence of the Rebbe. It's like the sun, right? It's everywhere. That's what his Bjort said, his Gimel Thomas, when the sun was stopped in the sky, it just shines everywhere. There's no eluding his influence. Every great movement of other Jews, you should see the little stories that happened with the Baba Sali, the Rebbe Mamash giving him instructions, and even Rebbe Nachman, the Rebbe was Mamash printing his books and building up everything that's happening in the Jewish world today, has the Rebbe's name on it. Eisha Torah, the Rebbe Mamash gave them a bracha to buy this building, even though they're like a whole institution which is promoting different philosophy. So he's everywhere at all times. This is what it means to be the Raya Mehemna. So if you don't see his greatness, it's just because you're not looking. It's like the burning bush, right? Moshe could have just walked by that bush. It's a bush on fire. I don't see anything here. He looked back. He's like, wait a minute. Wait a second. This guy, you're telling me he only slept a half an hour a day and he printed more books than any other person in the history of the world. Okay, and then we have 10,000 hours of videotape of him teaching Torah. Like, there's no one ever not like him, right? Because even David HaMelech inside of him, and even Shlomo HaMelech inside of him. So this is what I'm saying. When you get the bug, we call it drinking the Kool-Aid. There's no going home. Like the Rebbe takes over the situation, and you can't finish his Torah. You know, you can finish Shas. You really can't finish the Rebbe's Torah. It goes on forever. There's so many. Anyway, I've lost the plot entirely. But there's there is one more point. Chaim, go for it, man.
I've heard, like,
Rabbi Rome, you can't put this class out.
No, this is important.
Wait for this class.
Really good class.
All right.
The argument that the Rambam poskim back then,
right,
that until we can't identify who Mashiach, I understand the Rebbe was leader of the generation, and
on the contrary, the Rambam paskined the criteria in order to identify material. Yeah.
What is the criteria? That there's a Beit HaMikdash?
No, there's two levels of criteria. There's what's called Cheskas Mashiach and Vaday Mashiach. Each one has its own set of criteria. They passed, not right now, the class is over, but you can read it in the Rambam. In the Laws of Kings and Their Wars. The Rambam paskined what the criteria are in order to become the presumed Mashiach in the generation.
Right.
And I later found out from great scholars that That's not necessarily presumed Mashiach in every generation. That he what he was talking about, the presumed Mashiach is there's Mashiach,
the final.
And he goes through two. Yeah, the final. There's one, yeah. And he goes through two stages. One, he's presumed to be Mashiach, and then ultimately he is Mashiach. So they paskin in Am Yisrael, a huge gathering of rabbanim from all walks of life. They actually paskined. The Rebbe asked them. Not about himself. The Rebbe said, we have to bring down Mashiach in law. Since the Torah runs the world, so long as the Torah has not declared Mashiach is here, then he's not here. So when people heard that, they all got together. This was like the Rebbe's heyday. His mom was making open miracles in the news. Everyone got together in the world from all walks of life. They paskin based on the Rambam's laws and Hilchas Malachim Milchoseim, when he was still alive, that the Rebbe is Cheskas Mashiach. So what they, it means he's presumed to be Mashiach.
Fine, but then
so my point is that there's not, I later found out that if you read like the fine print, there isn't a cheskes, there is someone who's fit to be Mashiach in every generation. Right. But to have the actual, like to be called Al Pi Torah's Emes, to be cheskes Mashiach, it only happens once. And then it's just a matter of time until cheskes Mashiach becomes Bada Mashiach. So the certainly Mashiach.
No, that's why I don't get the point. Because Nachman said in the Gemara, Kigon Ana, I could be Mashiach, Rabbi Yehuda. No. And he also gave about Rabbi Wei.
Yeah, no, there's one who's fit to be Mashiach.
Exactly.
But
so
that doesn't mean. No.
But when they made the declaration.
Being fit to be Mashiach means there's a particular soul who, if the Am Yisrael would come and paskin and identify him with all the signs that he's Cheskas Mashiach, then it would be that guy who would be chosen to fit the criteria of Cheskas Mashiach. They never happened before. Right? So, except for in the Rabbi Akiva's day, but then he was puzzled because one of the laws of Mashiach is he can't be murdered. So that was a close, but no cigar. He didn't reach to Vaday Mashiach. Anyway, I don't know if he actually got the din of Ches Mashiach, but if Rabbi Akiva signed on, it's a good, good.
What's going to happen next, so to speak, right? We don't have.
We know that take of Miad Mamish Mashiach Tikenu is coming to a town near you. All right. Shkoyach.
That was a good